perhaps you heard it said to avoid the topics of money and politics. If you want to have a decent conversation with somebody, you won't hear me speaking about politics, but you will hear me speaking about your possessions, your money, the things the Lord has given to you. And that's because the Lord Jesus himself speaks about those things. And this morning we have an opportunity to measure what we have earthly with what we have spiritually. Because we need that reminder to focus on the riches that we have in our Savior Jesus Christ and to guard and keep them as strenuously as possible. It's this morning that the Lord Jesus shares those riches with us through his word and the sacrament. May the Holy Spirit bless us as we worship together as sisters and brothers in Christ. Good morning and welcome to all of you. Today's order of worship begins on page 154. If you're using the hymnal, let's join now in the opening hymn.
Sins to the Lord. Almighty and merciful Father, we have strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed what we have devised and desired in our hearts. We have offended you and sinned against your holy law. We have done those things that we should not have done, and we have not done those things that we should have done. Have mercy on us, Lord. Spare us, forgive us, and restore us according to your promises in Christ Jesus. God, our merciful Father, has forgiven all our sins. He sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer and Savior. Jesus paid the penalty for our guilt by his death on the cross and freed us from death by his resurrection from the grave. We have peace with God now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. We praise you, we bless you, we worship you, we glorify you, we give thanks to you for your great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us.
Grant us the full measure of your grace, that we may obtain your promises and become partakers of your heavenly glory, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The congregation may be seated. Today's first reading is from the book of 1 Kings, chapter 3. In this reading, we hear of Solomon asking the Lord for wisdom instead of material possessions. That wisdom included the fear of the Lord, as Solomon would write in the Proverbs, that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. What an example for us all. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon during the night in a dream and said, "Ask for whatever you want me to give you." Solomon answered, "You have shown great kindness to your servant, my father David, because he was faithful to you and righteous and upright in his heart. You have continued this great kindness to him and have given him a son to sit on his throne this very day. Now, Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David. But I am only a little child and do not know how to carry out my duties. Your servant is here among the people you have chosen, a great people, too numerous to count or number. So give your servant a discerning heart to govern your people and to distinguish between right and wrong. For who is able to govern this great people of yours?" The Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for this. So God said to him, "Since you have asked for this and not for long life or wealth for yourself, nor have asked for the death of your enemies, but for discernment in administering justice, I will do what you have asked. I will give you a wise and discerning heart so that there never will have been anyone like you, nor will there ever be." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm of the day is number 63. We'll read it responsively. You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you. In a dry and parched land, where there is no water, I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. This morning's second reading is from Paul's first letter to Timothy, chapter 6. In this reading, we hear of Paul's warnings to those who are wealthy, and also the encouragement for us to make spiritual wealth our highest desire. This reading will serve later as our sermon text. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to your care. Turn away from godless chatter and the opposing ideas of what is falsely called knowledge, which some have professed, and in so doing have departed from the faith. Grace be with you all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Alleluia. Please stand for today's gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 13. We hear of Jesus speaking in parables about what is truly wealth, the gospel, the kingdom of God, your faith in Christ. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up on the shore. Then they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad away. This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the blazing furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things? Jesus asked. Yes, they replied. He said to them, therefore every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated for the singing of the hymn of the day.
Thank you.
Jesus is my all. What is the world to me? Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the rock of our salvation, dear Christian friends. It's been said that there are only two kinds of people in this world. Those who want to get wealthy and those who are wealthy. Just two kinds. Those who want to get wealthy and those who are wealthy. Do you agree with that? Well, with only a little bit of thinking, you can probably recall that the fact that for thousands of years, people have recognized greed as one of the deadly sins. And one way of avoiding greed is for people to take a vow of poverty and to live an impoverished life. Some have even done that inside of Christianity. But in general, does that describe people and put them into two groups, those who want to get wealthy and those who are wealthy? I suppose it's useful. So then the question is, which group do you belong to? And at first you might say, well, I'm certainly not the wealthy group. Forbes doesn't even consider my net worth when it's coming out with its 100 wealthiest people. But think about it. To a vast minority of people in this world, you are wealthy. They live in poverty. You have more than they can imagine. And from time to time, we dream of what it would be like to be filthy rich, what we would do, the good things we would do with it. So yes, I suppose it's fairly useful to say that there are people who want to be rich and those who are rich. And I wonder if the person who first authored that statement, that assessment, read 1 Timothy chapter 6 before she or he came up with it. Now, why would I say that? Because in the first part of 1 Timothy chapter 6, St. Paul warns against wanting riches. He says, those who want to get rich fall into a spiritual trap that leads to death and destruction. And now in the last part of 1 Timothy chapter 6, the words that are before us this morning, he talks to people who are wealthy. And he has advice. Advice for us, wealthy people that we are. The Lord is speaking to us this morning. He's giving us his advice, so let's listen. Listen to your Lord's advice about your wealth. Let's see the points that he makes. Do you know humble people who are rich? Humble people who are rich. I suppose if you think about it, you can come up with a name or two. But in general, that's not the case, is it? In general, our impression of the very wealthy people are that they are pretentious and arrogant. They are haughty with their wealth. They consider themselves to be several levels above us in society. They take pains to avoid dealing with the hoi polloi. They like it the way they are up in the stratosphere of wealth, and they intend to remain there at all costs. They are so bare, our impression is that they are so buried in their money that they have no idea what it's like for you and me to live, sometimes wondering how we're going to pay the next bill. Then it's no wonder why the Lord addresses wealthy people. Here in these words of our text, command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant. Paul gives Timothy a task that might not have been pleasant or easy. He wants Timothy, his young apostle, to approach Christian people who are wealthy and command them not to be arrogant. Obviously, that was a temptation among the early Christians, just as it's a temptation among us. But arrogance? Really? Warn people against arrogance? Where does arrogance fall on your scale of deadly sins? Probably near the bottom, right? So why would Paul warn against arrogance so clearly? Because arrogance is a sin against the very first commandments. It is idolization of self. Paul also has another warning. He tells Christians not to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain. He's referring to materialism here. Materialism is the thinking that my worth and my security come from what I have and how much of it I have. It's the false thinking that we will be happy as soon as we get that next thing that our sinful heart desires. Does it work?
I've tried it. I'm sure you have too. It doesn't work. There's always the next thing out there. Instead, Paul urges wealthy people to be humble. Humble. But how can that happen? When they realize that spiritually they are absolutely no different from the poorest person. When they realize that they're no different from the rest of us. They have sinned against the holy God and do not deserve his favor but his punishment. The fact that they possess a tremendous amount of wealth or things is not an indication from God that he's really pleased with them. No, those things are a gift of his grace, and he gives to each one as he determines. And so he says, wealthy Christian, recognize that. You know better than anybody else. And then put your hope in the Lord. Remember that whether you consider yourself to be wealthy or not, everything you have could be taken away from you tomorrow. Remember how the Lord dealt with Job, one of the wealthiest people ever. In a day it was all gone, and soon even his health was gone. The Lord could allow that. But he wants you to put your hope in the Lord, meaning even if you lose everything in your life, you still have what counts most, your faith, your relationship with Jesus Christ. Your hope is in the Lord. Wealthy Christian, listen to your Lord's advice about your wealth. Have a Christian attitude about it. What do you hear about more often? Really wealthy people who do really bad things with their money, or really wealthy people who do really good things with their money? I don't know about you, but I usually hear about the latter. The really good things that wealthy people are doing with their money, the foundations that they establish, foundations which support cancer research or which pay for the education of those who cannot afford their education, and the list goes on and on and on. You hear about those foundations every day, wealthy people doing tremendously good things with the money that they possess. But wealthy Christians have the highest of motivation to do that very thing. You see, wealthy Christians know the love of Christ. Wealthy Christians know that Christ paid what they could never pay for with all of their wealth. Paid the debt of sin that they owe. Paid the price God demanded. Paid the price so that you can belong to Christ forever. And so the wealth, whatever measure that is, the wealth that God gives us is an opportunity for us then to show our love for Christ by the way that we do those things. And to make it clear what he's talking about, Paul then makes a list. He says, command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasures for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age. When Paul urges wealthy people to do good things with their wealth, he's thinking about good things in God's way of thinking, good and honorable to God. He tells them not to be stingy, but instead to share with others. And one of the words he uses here in the Greek indicates use your wealth in order to develop fellowship with other people, people who are less fortunate than you are. Influence them in a good way. Bless them through the blessings that you have. In such a way, develop a relationship with them. Certainly, Paul's implication would be that you have an opportunity then to witness to your faith by the way that you use your wealth. Our Lord gives us guidelines. Our Lord gives us advice on Christian behaviors with your wealth. Listen to it. As happens so often in our lives, the best is saved for last. That awesome dessert comes after what was a tremendous meal. Paul has been feeding us advice on how to use our wealth, and his third course is the best. He says it like this: take hold of the life that is truly life. Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to your care. Certainly, our Lord is concerned about how you use your wealth in this life. That's the main point of the first half of the verses of our text. All instruction, all advice on how to use our wealth. But our Lord's main purpose is not to provide us with a quick reference guidebook on how to use our wealth on a daily basis. No, his main concern is your spiritual wealth.
He calls it the life. The life that is yours. Think about it. The Bible describes people who have no life with Jesus Christ as being dead. They really have no life at all. And unless the Holy Spirit changes that by giving them faith in Christ, it will lead to eternal separation from God. That's not you. By God's grace, you have life. Life with Christ. Take hold of that life, Paul says. Make that your greatest endeavor. He has given it to you. Now make use of it. Make sure you take care of it. Nurture it. It's your stewardship of spiritual wealth. In fact, Paul goes on to tell Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to your care. Paul is not urging Timothy or you or me to increase the security cameras around our home or in our businesses and in such a way protect them from thieves. No, he's talking about spiritual things. And he is warning against the greatest thief this world has ever encountered, Satan, who is trying to rob what God has given you, a relationship with Jesus Christ, every moment of your life. And one of his satanic methods is false teaching, which St. Paul goes on and on about in the final verses of our text. So Paul's encouragement to you is, guard what you have in your heart, the gospel, the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Be good stewards of it. Make sure that gospel is your main focus. Make sure you are hearing that gospel and receiving that Lord's Supper. It's the greatest thing you can do in order to guard the wealth that God has given you. What advice. He's truly concerned about us, not just here and now, but eternally. Listen to your Lord's advice about your wealth and practice Christian stewardship regarding it. I don't think a day goes by in which you don't hear advice for you about your wealth. Television commercials are filled with it, the media is too. They all want to give you advice on how you should use what you have. And when you receive that advice, then it's up to you whether or not to put it into practice. Your Lord has been speaking to you this morning, not just some human being. He's given you divine advice about how to use what he has given you. So, how have we done? Well, I can only speak personally. He has told me not to be selfish. He's warned me against selfishness and stinginess. I've not heeded that warning. He's warned me about not caring for others and all the while simply caring about myself. I've not heeded that warning. He's told me, he's given me an advice, don't worry so much about this life. Worry more about what's coming. And I've not heeded that advice either too often in my life. I'm so busy with what's going on here in the now that I lose track of what my Savior really wants me to pay attention to. How about you? Truth is, we're guilty. We've shunned divine advice. But you have the gospel. That gospel has been entrusted to you. The Lord Jesus, by the word of the Holy Spirit, has placed it in your heart. And that gospel announces to you, not guilty. Not of a single sin, because your Lord Jesus paid for them all. He loves you with an eternal love and wants nothing to stand in your way of your relationship with him. So listen to your Lord's advice and then pray with me. Lord, help me make your priorities for my life, my priorities for my life. Lord, empower me to use what you've given me to your glory and to help others. Chiefly, help me treasure that gospel you placed in my heart and to share that gospel with others. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God which surpasses all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We now join in confessing the Christian faith using the Nicene Creed. We
believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Almighty God and Father, we thank you for all your mercies, especially for the gift of your Son, to whom you have revealed your gracious will. We praise you for the Holy Spirit that is working through the means of grace. Plant your word in our hearts and cause it to produce fruit in our lives. Strengthen and defend your church, that by your word and sacraments, faith may grow and love toward all may increase. Support all who spread the light of your truth throughout the world. Keep our children in the grace of their baptisms. Enable their parents to train them in lives of faith. Raise up Christians to serve you in the ministry of the word and in all godly walks of life. Preserve our nation in justice and honor. Guide and bless all who make, administer, and judge our laws. Give them wisdom that they may promote justice and hinder evil. Let your blessing rest on planting and harvest, commerce and industry, medicine and science, the arts and culture. Protect all who travel and care for those whose work is difficult or dangerous. Be with all who devote themselves to any useful task. Comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. Remember those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those for whom death draws near. Grant them your love and take them into your tender care. Heavenly Father, as our Synod Convention opens this week, we humbly thank you that you've bought us with the blood of your dear Son, our Savior, and that you've made us your children by faith in him and permitted us to be workers together with you in your kingdom. Lay your blessings upon our convention. Give those who act for us wisdom from on high. Grant the delegates unity of spirit. Help us all accept and obey each and every part of your word. Bestow on our Synod President a double portion of your spirit so that he may lead the convention in godliness, decently, and in order. Guided by you, may he guide our delegates only in your ways. Let all of our officers and committees seek only your glory and the good of your children. Help us in our convention to preserve and defend the truth which you have deposited in our hearts. Make us eager and able to preach the gospel to every creature. Through us, send forth laborers into your harvest. Redouble our zeal to work while it is day, before the night comes when no one can work. Hear us and help us and bless our convention for Jesus' sake. Hear us, Lord, as we pray in silence. We remember with thanksgiving those who have loved and served you, who now rest from their labors. Console those who are mourning or living with sadness. Keep us in the true faith and bring us at last to the joys of heaven. Grant us these things, Father, for the sake of Jesus, who died and rose again. Amen.
The congregation may be seated for the offering. Sacrament portion of the order of worship on page 12 of your worship folder. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is good and
that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who promised that wherever two or three come together in his name, there he is with them to shepherd his flock until he comes again in glory. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song.
Holy.
Whom you sent to be our Savior, our Redeemer, and the messenger of your grace. Through him you made all things. In him you are well pleased. He is the incarnate Word, conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. To fulfill your promises, he stretched out his hands on the cross and released from eternal death all who believe in you. As we remember Jesus' death and resurrection, we thank you that you've gathered us together to receive your Son's body and blood. Send us your Spirit, unite us as one, and strengthen our faith so that we may praise you in your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we glorify and honor you, O God our Father, with the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Stanzas 1, 4, and 5. After that, communicants, please follow the direction of the usher in approaching the front of the church to receive communion. Guests and visitors, our communion practice is at the bottom of page 1 of your worship folder.
Thank you.
poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. May it strengthen and keep you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Strengthen and keep you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Amen.
Thank you.
Please stand. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this saving gift. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for the closing hymn.
Thank you.
joining me this morning in this service of praise to our Savior, who is the gospel, the precious gospel, our precious treasure. And it's my prayer that that gospel will go with you in the week ahead as it guides you and comforts you and empowers you to live to the glory of your Savior, Jesus Christ, and to be good stewards of that gospel that is in your hearts. If you're visiting with us for the first time this morning, it's been a pleasure for me to share that gospel with you. Please leave us with your information, your name and address on the guest book on the desk in the church entryway. There are August newsletters and calendars available, hard copies on the table. I'll send out a digital copy soon. You heard me pray for the Synod Convention, which will open this week. I will send out a link. The opening service is tomorrow evening. I think it's at 6 o'clock at St. Paul Lutheran Church in Saginaw, Michigan. So I'll send out a link. Tremendous music at that service tomorrow, I guarantee you. Also, on Tuesday morning, then, will be the election of officers. And it's been a privilege for me to be the second vice president of our synod for more than a decade. And in our church body, you don't run for office. You allow your name to be considered. And with the support of our voters, I'm going to allow my name to be considered to continue serving as the second vice president. But maybe the delegates will have something else in mind. Again, you can watch the convention on the link. Again, that election will take place Tuesday morning. This morning, we have with us Chris Kluger and his wife, Janine. Chris is overseeing Bible translation work in the country of Ethiopia. He's going to be making a presentation here in a moment, a couple of minutes, and we'll have a fellowship cookout. But Chris has something he wants to share with all of you before we dismiss.
Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Most of you know me. My name is Chris. Like Pastor said, my wife, Janine, and I get to work in Ethiopia, helping translate the Bible for people who don't have it in their language yet. And wouldn't you know it, you guys have been helping us do that for more than a decade. First, we served in Zambia for 5 years and brought the New Testament into a brand new language for the very first time there. You were with us the whole time. We had a little break in South Dakota, but now we're in Ethiopia, hard at work again. I hope you can all stay and listen to the presentation as we're talking about that. If you can't, stop by the table, the round table in the back of the fellowship hall, and pick up one of these cards. These just kind of remind you to pray for us, that we desperately need your prayers for the work that we're doing. And thank you for that. So, but hopefully you can stay. And even if you don't, I wanted everybody to be able to see this, because this is our chance, Janine and my chance, to say thank you to Resurrection Lutheran Church for years and years of support of Bible translation work. So on behalf of the Bible-less people of Ethiopia, we're presenting this Ethiopian blessing cross to the church, and thank you for all of your support.
Thank you, Chris, and God bless you.
Thanks. Continues.
All right. We'll bow our heads for prayer, since we'll be eating soon. I hope most of you can stay, but let's bow and ask the Lord to bless us. Lord, you have been with us, as you promised this morning, feeding our souls on you, the bread of life, through your word and sacrament. We ask you now to bless also the food that's been prepared for us this noon hour. Use it to strengthen our bodies as we listen to the tremendous work of Bible translation, Bible translating in Ethiopia. We ask that you bless our time together and bless the work that Chris and Janine are continuing to do. Bless them with safe travels as they depart for Ethiopia this week. We pray in your name, O Lord. Amen. Have a blessed day.